Hello and welcome to Piping Up, presented by the Tabernacle Choir at Temple Square. I'm your host, Luke Howard. Today's organist, Brian Mathias, begins with a recessional. Yes, that's correct, composed by the former Tabernacle organist, Robert Cundick. But even though Cundick titled this 1975 piece a recessional, he approved of its use as a processional as well. Musically speaking, there's not that much difference between the two genres. It simply depends on where in the program the music is happening. Anyone who has studied tonal music theory understands the harmonic significance of a pedal point. Tonal harmony is commonly heard and analyzed in relation to the lowest note, the bass note of the chord. And when that bass note is held for a long time, say, for example, on the pedal of an organ piece, then it becomes a pedal point. And everything that happens harmonically in the other parts is anchored by the powerful harmonic pull of that pedal point. J.S. Bach understood better than any composer the emotional power of dissonance. He used it with extraordinary finesse, especially when he wished to express emotional tension in a cantata, a chorale harmonization, or works where the text indicated grief, suffering, anguish, or distress. And he applied that principle to purely instrumental works as well, in order to elicit the same effective response in the hearer. When dissonances are untethered and the harmonic tension compounds with each new chord, there's a palpable sense of feeling harmonically lost or uncertain. The passage of music shifts anxiously, aimlessly, seeking resolution but not knowing where to find it. But that same passage, when played over a pedal point, takes on the harmonic stability of that bass note. It is anchored, and the dissonant movement can be heard as departing from or moving toward the resolution and consonance established by the pedal point. I realize this description is a metaphor. We're applying labels of human emotions to an essentially acoustic phenomenon. But this is how Bach and his colleagues thought about music and its potential to move the listener. In our own experiences, too, there are times when life's dissonances seem to compound on each other, making us feel untethered from the spiritual and emotional consonance we crave. St. Paul taught that a hope in God's immutable counsel can be an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, by which we can tell more clearly if we are departing from or approaching nearer to the peace and reconciliation God offers. That formidable pedal point of spiritual hope pulls us to where we want and need to be. We'll hear now Bach's marvelous application of both untethered dissonance and the power of pedal points in the Fantasia in G minor from BWV 542. And then Brian will play the finale from Felix Mendelssohn's Organ Sonata No. 6, the last movement of his last organ sonata, which functions as a kind of benediction on the whole set. Today, it also offers a comforting amen to Bach's G minor Fantasia.
Thank you.
the Latter-day Saint hymn, Come, Come Ye Saints, has been played at these organ concerts on Temple Square for well over a century. We'll hear Brian's arrangement of that wonderful hymn tune, followed by his arrangement of Beautiful Savior. The melody of Beautiful Savior was originally a Silesian folk tune, harmonized in 1850 by the American composer Richard Storrs Willis, who studied with Mendelssohn and is best known as the composer of the popular American melody For It Came Upon the Midnight Clear. In fact, both that Christmas carol and Willis's harmonization of Beautiful Savior were first published in the same volume, Church Chorals and Choir Studies, from 1850. Willis may also have had a hand in the translation of the original German text into English. So first, Come, Come Ye Saints, then Beautiful Savior. There's no question that César Franck was deeply committed to the organ as an instrument of worship in a sacred space. He was, after all, organist at the Basilica of Santa Clotilde in Paris for more than 30 years, and many of his sacred vocal works include organ accompaniment. But Franck's solo organ compositions show that he also perceived the organ's potential as a concert instrument. In 1878, the first large organ to be installed in a concert space in France was inaugurated at the Trocadéro as part of the Paris World's Fair that year. And Franck produced three new concert organ works for the occasion. To conclude our program now, we'll hear one of those works, the magnificent Pièce, héroïque by César Franck. We're glad you joined us for today's episode of Piping Up with organist Brian Mathias. Thank you for watching. You are always welcome to return for the weekly live stream of these concerts, and previous episodes are also available for on-demand viewing. More information about this program, including a link to submit listener requests, can be found at tabchoir.org/pipingup. Piping Up, Organ Concerts at Temple Square, streams live every Wednesday at noon Mountain Time on the Tabernacle Choir's website, its Facebook page and YouTube channel, and at broadcasts.churchofjesuschrist.org.